Welcome everyone, and thanks for joining us today. I'm Alexandra Haisley, a Marketing Manager here at Perficient. I'm excited to be moderating today's webinar, the next in our digital transformation series, Modernizing Core Technology to Accelerate Digital Transformation. We are recording today, and we will be sure to email you with information on how to access it after the session. Time permitting, we'll also be answering questions at the end of the presentation. At any time during the call, if you have questions, please use the chat box to ask those, and I'll put them in a queue for the end. Now for a little bit about Perficient. We are the leading digital transformation consulting firm serving global 2000 and enterprise customers here in North America. We focus on delivering digital experience, business optimization, and industry solutions. We have a broad range of locations, as you can see, across the United States. And here are just a couple quick facts about Perficient. We're founded in 1997, and we have almost 3,000 employees. Now, I also wanted to do a quick intro of our strategic capabilities. Today's speakers are actually from our strategic advisory group and provide thought leadership across management consulting, IT modernization, digital experience, and enterprise information management. Now to give you a quick introduction of our speakers, Michael Porter leads our strategic advisory team comprised of experienced, knowledgeable experts in a variety of areas. He has worked with technology and digital strategy for over 20 years. He works with clients to help them devise their digital transformation strategy and drive success in an ever more complex digital world. Eric Roch is the principal consultant for IT modernization solutions. Eric has more than 20 years of experience across IT, including executive level management within industry and consulting as a technical architect and an application and systems development. Now I'll hand it over to Mike.
Thank you. So we want to do an introduction. You know, today is all about modernizing core technology to accelerate digital transformation. But the reality is that in order to understand why you're doing it, you need to understand some of the trends behind that. And this isn't going to be anything new in terms of what you see, but these are the things that should drive you to think about how to change and what to change as we turn the time over to Eric a little bit later on. Number one is rising at customer expectations. You know, every time some other firm, not yourself, does something great and creates a great customer experience, those expectations are what you get. You know, of course, continual connectedness. Every time we turn around, Verizon, Sprint, T-Mobile, you name these major vendors are adding better, faster, and more qualitative connections. That drives, by the way, a velocity. You see more and more companies being able to do more and more quickly, or at least potentially your competitors, and that, of course, drives an abundance of customer data. There's lots of data with which you can create a great customer experience. The question is how do you sift through the abundance of data to actually create something? You put all that together, and there's a lot going on inside of the industry. And think about what that means in terms of your organization. If you look through this list, and I'm not going to go through every single one, but you probably see some elements of your own company. There's a lot of things that are digital gaps that keep you from creating a great customer experience. And let me give you one example. If you go over to platforms under non-integrated as one of the examples, we were working with a company. And I won't name them, but they do a lot of business to consumer, and they sell to consumers, but they do it through a variety of channels, not the least of which is their own website. But what they wanted to do was to expand those channels, and they went and talked to a couple of partners, and one partner said, "Love to work with you. Tell me about how we're going to integrate to you. What's your APIs? What are your APIs?" And the answer was, well, we don't have APIs, at least not externally focused APIs or externally accessible APIs that are only just available internally. And the answer was, when you have those APIs that can be accessible externally and you give us the easy-to-use approach on how to use them, in other words, I want them to be restful, I want them to be well-maintained, I want them to be well-documented, and so on and so forth, then we can talk. And those are kind of keys in terms of there's a digital gap, and not being integrated can actually have an impact on you creating an experience and, of course, on you driving a variety of customer experiences that end up with revenue themselves. So there's some ideas. And, Eric, I know you probably had some ideas here as well, some digital gaps.
Sure. I'd like to speak to this side a bit just to set the scope of the problem we're looking at. So these user experience issues show up as a result often of issues around people, process, and platforms. So just to get an idea of the scope, I recently worked with a bank, and they have about 10, 15, or I guess about 12 legacy systems that they're integrated to, but very loosely. And their whole IT pass has been maintaining those systems and reducing cost. Well, now they're expected to take these 12 systems and put it in the context of a mobile application, and it's a very big struggle. The people are not used to delivering those kind of applications. The systems are all dated and have no APIs, as you just said. So those are the type of problems that we look at, is those kind of big kind of business system, IT system process issues that we'd like to cover.
Mm-hmm. Now, before we hit deep into that, think about what digital transformation means. And there's two elements of it to it. Number one, it's about differentiation. How do you differentiate yourself? How do you create that great customer experience? And that's less of a focus today. The other is on efficiency, the operational excellence side of the coin. And when we say efficiency, don't think that efficiency means cost cutting. That's not what we're talking about. What we're talking about is the use of technologies, tools, and processes to allow you to more efficiently get things out the door, to more efficiently create those customer experiences. And that's an important element because, yes, you want to use your budget wisely and focus on how to invest, but you have to do it in such a way that increases the velocity at which you can get functionality out the door, at which you can create those great customer experiences. So with that in mind, another thing that's core to this is the idea, again, customer first. Customer touch points expose the IT weaknesses, right? The example that we gave with that one company that didn't have an API, or the example that Eric gave where you want to do an indoor experience pick up in-store experience if you're part of a retailer, but you can't do that unless you're thinking through everything. And first off, that you need to think it through is how your business process works. What's driving the change? Is it your back end, or is it customer insight that's driving that? And the point we want to make is customer insight. Those touch points with your customers and the resulting insights themselves should drive your teams, your processes, and your systems. So keep that in mind. That's a part of your prioritization. That's a part of how you go forward, and that's a part of how you're going to make this work overall. I'll turn the time over to Eric to talk a little bit more about operational excellence.
Thanks. So let's take a look first at some Forrester recommendations in this area. So the idea of operational excellence and kind of meeting customer expectations. The advice in this paper referenced at the bottom here of the slide that CIOs should ramp up their digital operations innovation. So really look at how to do new things. And in order to do that, their first suggestion is to look at customer journey maps to find low-hanging fruit. And we're going to spend more time on that, talking about the journey maps and opportunities and so forth. Also, partner with operational leaders to drive needed changes. I think this is very important. If you start thinking about the silos within companies and how you need to look across those operational silos, for example, how does procurement interface with sales to get product onto a website, for example. It's these handoffs between these operational systems that have often siloed systems that create inefficiencies, or often also bad data that shows up on websites and mobile and so forth. Stand up in innovation hubs that to address this kind of business operation issues, and we'll go into that as well. So how do you overcome some of the people, skill problems, cultural changes, and things like that. So we'll talk about that in the road mapping exercises as well. There's also some interesting here in this chart, some interesting data. The idea that you have different maturities around digital, and Forrester calls that a predator, a transformer, and a dinosaur. So if you look, this idea of e-commerce, the transformers are looking at spending money there, where the predators and the more advanced are looking at things like marketing, and then interestingly enough, IT is how do you improve IT around these functions and so forth to get better. So obviously to improve the velocity of systems and things like that, and we'll talk about those topics.
Yeah, and this is Mike. I find it fascinating, by the way, that it's a transformer will focus on the digital transformation or the commerce component, but look how much the digital predators do everything else. We have one particular example with
right.
a customer of ours. They spent all of their time initially focusing on how to improve the commerce site, but they lacked actually key digital sales and digital marketing capabilities that ultimately impacted the ability of the commerce component to be successful. So you love the fact that predators especially are focusing in their efforts across all elements here.
Right. You know, but your e-commerce example is like a bolt-on. I like to call that a bolt-on technology where it may not be well integrated and things like that, and then you have to get past that kind of bolt-on and address these other issues. So looking at Journey Map, back to kind of Forrester's recommendation, it's certainly something that Perficient's very well versed in. We do this with our customers on a regular basis. So looking at the customer's journey through all the interactions with the brand, through all the transactions that are executed, for example, not just the ordering the product, but all the logistics, things like returns, stockouts on the back-end systems, those kind of things that you need to address. If all of those are not efficient, then you're going to end up with customer expectation gaps. So the next thing is in this customer journey, when we're looking at those touch points, we look at what are the pain points and what are the opportunities. Then the next level down, which we're going to be talking about today, is what are the underlying systems and processes and platforms that support this customer experience. So what is underneath there, so we can start looking at making operational efficient improvements. So Perficient has seven dimensions that we look at customer experience maturity. And today we'll be focusing on these underlying IT systems, the platforms, and these operational processes. So first, let's really start to understand what are the challenges. So if you look at legacy systems, for example, you can think of your business model. At the time they were written, someone built this and hard-coded in like COBOL or whatever it may be, if it's mainframe, for example, or even Java, more kind of modern but still old. They hard-coded the business model and how it works through all the organizations. So, and it's also siloed, so they went and said, well, procurement, what do you have to do to order products, get into the warehouse? Sales, what do you have to do to sell? And there's often a gap between those systems. So the people then are, and vice versa, the organization is kind of determines what the applications are going to be built, and then it kind of hard codes it. And then you have this whole idea around IT that they are managing these older systems, and then they just keep the lights on, so to speak, and then also they become fragmented between the different departments, lack of integration. And then when you do something, as we said before, like bolt on e-commerce on top of that or bolt on mobile, all of those, that underlying problems and issues become really manifested in that user experience. So at this point, we'd like to take a short survey. If you could just please click all of these that are relevant and your kind of greatest operational challenges to achieve your company's business, digital business goals, and you can just select all that apply. And then I'll show you the results. You'll have some coming in. Okay, let's take a look. Business and IT process gaps. So that's always a big one. The ones that I see a lot on the surveys are the kind of organization people. So I would think that we've got more IT people on the call because there's definitely organizational issues all around, but it's a good scattering of kind of everything in there. Okay, thank you. So now let's go on to really assessing it. So the first thing to creating the plan is really understanding where you are now. So let's jump right in. So kind of a common way of looking at architecture is comparing yourself or comparing the what we typically call the as-is kind of architecture to some future state, so some desired state that you want to be in. But kind of the challenge is, well, what is that state? Let's look first at these platforms. The idea of a platform, and let me just define it, is something you build the business application on top of, like a mobile platform or something like this. And it's nice that Gartner has defined a model for digital business technology platform. So then we can actually use this model maybe as a starting point. You certainly want to adjust it for your particular needs, but you could use that as a starting point to compare yourself against and say, am I best in class in these areas? So if you look down at the list here, the first one is information systems platform. So that really is your business application. So if you're running an SAP or an Oracle or something like that, or maybe a SaaS application like Salesforce.com and on, those systems. So how do those stack up? You could compare and say, what often happens is people have multiples of those, and you really need to rationalize it and get it down to one really best-in-class product. The next one's customer experience, so that would be your websites, your content management, e-commerce, those kind of things. Data and analytics, the kind of self-explanatory. Internet of Things, that's going to be important to some people, like if you have digital products, for example, and those products phone home, so to speak, and give status and things like that, then that certainly would be important there. Ecosystems, really, how do you integrate to your partners, the people that you collaborate with through really common, like APIs is the technology there. So like API management, those sort of products. So if you take that framework and start considering, well, what really would add value, and of course tying that back to what you want to accomplish from the user experience, and what are the technology platforms that you need to implement, and then start breaking those down, and then you can start planning around those platforms. So for example, cloud, you could look at, well, cloud, I could maybe get away from legacy, move to a SaaS application, move to infrastructure as a service to get velocity and deploys and things like that, and on and on. So APIs to foster innovation so people can reuse assets and have self-service around the APIs so I can just build something and try it and that sort of thing. So just on and on across these, and what you're going, the benefits and the value that you would get from some of these transformative technologies. So then you would look at really what are the gaps, where do I want to be, what does the current state look like, and then you also need to start looking at the kind of the people and the process side of things as well. So kind of anybody can stand up a new platform, but really being innovative on that platform and changing your culture around things like agile development, DevOps, and those things are really harder to do. It kind of goes back to that survey where what is hard is kind of these organizational chart changes that are often very difficult. So again, back to the platforms, it's really what do you have now? So it's somewhat of an inventory, what's there, categorize it, and so forth. How does that current state compare to best in class? And I on the right here, I've got a chart that was actually I did with a client and looking at the integration tools that they use to kind of categorize these integration tools and then mapped it back just to Gartner Magic Quadrant to show them where they were, where they had gaps, something that's really easy and quick to do, and then you know that would give a kind of good high-level indication that where you're some gaps. Let's talk about business value around where your gaps are, what you would get from them, that sort of thing. The other thing is just how critical is that platform to your digital strategy? So if you lack a capability, so to speak, how critical is that? And then you can also ask, what is the investment it would take to close that gap? So those are the kind of conversations you can start to have. Another way to look at this, a little more complicated, is really comparing yourself against reference architecture. So here is, and I don't expect it's like an eye chart, but for you to read it, but on the left is a data platform, so data hubs, data lakes, that sort of thing, landing pads, all those kind of technologies. And then on the right is integration, so like integration platforms as a service, ESB, legacy, API management, those kind of things. So if you need those pieces, you pair yourself and say, here's where I have gaps, and also start to align yourself with really best practices on how these products work together. So you can come see where your gaps are in the your reference from the reference architecture to the as-is, and then you can build that future state model using that reference architecture. So let's talk about just the people side of it as well. So there's a couple of things. It's always a touchy subject. I mean, people ask me, well, how do you look at people's skills and things like that, because it could obviously get to be a very personal thing. But if you really are looking at it differently, if you look at it from where is the company on, for example, on the maturity model, so how mature are you around governance? Because governance obviously has a people aspect of it. It's kind of the standards and the workflow that you go through and the policies that you have to step through to get things done, like develop software or deploy software. So if you look at it in the context of maturity, then you can define really where you are now. So where you are could be from interviews, from the questionnaires and things like that, assessing on different measurements on where you are, and then also setting up a target. So this is what it's going to take to move me to this target. So on the people side, that may include training. It might include implementing a governance model. It might include setting up a comedy center or a steering committee, so organizational change things that have to happen. So that's how you start introducing that thing and that kind of concept into it, as well as the aspect of measuring things going forward. So the other thing is this, what is the scope of this process change, and what all do I need to change in order to kind of become this more innovative company? A good model to look at is this idea that Gartner has around bimodal IT. So if you don't just at a high level, you could think of mode one as being more like a legacy system and mode two being more like an interactive system or like a mobile applications and that sort of thing. So those two different applications, and it's very common for a company to have the legacy system, obviously, but then want to move forward, and a lot of companies have already done that, this sort of thing. So they've got agile teams, for example, building websites. But it often goes much deeper than that. When we talked about operational excellence and looking at systems like procurement and things like that that are the underlying systems past those systems of engagement, you start looking at like governance models and how do you source those? How do you get people that are like not mainframe COBOL developers, for example, but more agile teams and specialized in cloud, native cloud development and that kind of talent. And then how do you also, so those are some of the things to think about. I like to look at these modes and say this is kind of where I need to shift some of my IT spend, for example. So back to these bullets on the left, you can look at setting up these, and Forrester had it in their report, and we call it Integration Lab, but I mean Innovation Lab. They call it Innovation Hub, but it really is carving out some functionality that you want to build. For example, we worked with a customer that wanted to do interactive banking, or digital banking, so carve that piece off, have a separate group around the innovation team that builds assets around that model, so APIs, data management, those kind of assets, pulls information off the mainframe and kind of has that in that innovation lab, then sets up standards and guidance, architecture patterns, governance frameworks, and introduces Agile and these other things in the context of that lab, but then pushes it out to the larger IT audience. So that's the idea. So if you look at just the concept, it's very popular now. DevOps, it's not always a well-liked term, but it's kind of what's out there. The idea of really squeezing inefficiencies out of IT, making IT more productive, and measuring your results, automating things from, if you think about Agile, where you're building things in these sprint teams. For example, in a 2-week sprint, you deliver some software functionality, if then it takes you a month to deploy it, or you have to stand up servers, and it may be even a longer, then the whole agility concept has been lost because of the time it takes you to do the deploys and such. So looking at that whole cycle, the collaboration between development and operations, so also understanding and being able to monitor what's going on in production and what is the capacity and that whole process around that. So it's a very important concept, and it's something that we often work into this idea of IT modernization along this kind of digital transformation. So we have another poll for you. What do you think your biggest gaps are in IT process, people, process, and platforms? Please select all that apply. You'll have some coming in. Okay, let's take a look. Agile DevOps style culture. That's not surprising. Software as a service. Modern IT platforms in lightweight governance or agility. So we see that a lot, the kind of the desire to be more agile, move to a DevOps. Of course, those require some organizational change, people change. So those are the harder things to do, as we stated earlier. Thank you. So let's talk more about building the actual roadmap. So we kind of went through what are the challenges. We know it's hard to do and so forth. We have to look at architecture. We have to look at people, process, and platform. So the other thing that we really need to do is address the actual execution of it. So we can talk about maturity models and things like that, but how do we actually turn these into projects, get funding for them, and execute them? It's a big challenge. So and then on the people side, we've got people that are still in the legacy mode. They've got systems to... And sometimes they actually cling to those systems and don't want them to change or resistant to change. So how do we overcome that? How do we improve these processes? And really you have to improve them through executing projects. I'm a firm believer, for example, that you can't get perfect at being agile or DevOps before you can roll out projects. You really have to get better and better at it, more or less through practicing it on those projects. So being able to execute those projects, and in the context of the project, then you're improving some of these IT skills. That's really key to making this work. And if you look at also on the execution side, the kind of that sponsorship, I know it's kind of overused. You got to have a good sponsor or you'll fail. But really it's all about the funding. It's about kind of the care and feeding of it. It's about showing wins and business value and all those things that you have to continually do. So along this roadmap, you have to have wins. And it's very important to pick that first project that's a big win and it's a big deal and celebrate it and evangelize concepts like API first and agility and those things throughout the company. Things like setting up a steering committee because you've got these cross-functional teams. Well, how are they going to communicate and make sure that we're working collaboratively versus separately? What about a digital program management office, someone to run it like a program and actually watch over these different projects that are executing over time? Finally, the idea of just setting these up to individual funded projects is often a gap. So if I go through a roadmap exercise, at the end of it, I want to have funded projects, or obviously you can't get started. So let's talk about how to do that, those things. At a high level, I mean, this is kind of a typical process. You've got to gather information, go through the current state analysis, gap analysis, define what the future state is, the projects that spin off from that, and they spin off if you look at them and think about them in business themes, so, and then also tracks to execute across. I'll talk about that more in a bit. but you really have to divide the work up enough that you can execute in a project, more of a project style, against this program, and then build a roadmap that's kind of the shared vision of where you want to go, and it has to be something that people can really understand. And that's a big deal here, is to start kind of top down, that you understand the business goals, and that's tied back to this whole idea of the customer experience and their journey maps, and that starts to drive what happens on these platforms, the people, process, and platform side. And then you have deliverables, for example, these future state architectures that are not so technical that certainly probably a business person's not going to understand it, but a developer should be able to understand it, not just an architect. And I've seen problems with that as well. Just the level of detail needs to be there, that needs to be right. It needs to be in model diagrams versus a lot of text, for example. You need to have a roadmap that executives understand and have buy-in for, but then enough detail later that you can run projects off of. So it's really all about the deliverables and what those deliverables need to be. And then you really need to break it down into these chunks of work that you can execute against. So I mentioned themes earlier. For example, if a theme is improve customer shipping times or delivery times, or improve customer satisfaction, which is pretty high level, you have to break that down into what that really means. So if you could start tying back these projects that you're going to execute on this roadmap to these business themes, and those business themes are tied back to this customer experience and expectations, then you start to have this everything align around that customer experience. And then you also have to break it down into tracks. I have some tracks. This is from a customer, but it was around some of these IT functions. So integration and data are become extremely important in the world where you start to take old monolithic systems and break that apart. So you take, for example, your CRM functionality and put it in Salesforce.com. Well, obviously now your data is somewhere else. You have to worry about the data management aspect of it, like mastering that customer information, and then the movement of it back and forth, the integration back to your website, those kind of things. So these platforms become very critical to really this whole modernization effort, which is we're doing really to improve customer expectations. So let's look at the steps at this high level, really to understand this customer experience through the journey maps, then start to look at what are the opportunities and pain points underneath there, what are the systems that are causing the pain points or present that opportunity for improvement. So that's tying that all back. You can also think of it, sometimes these systems can be very complicated. You know, I know I've worked for a lot of global companies, and they might have 10 different billing systems. I actually work with a company that did a lot of acquisitions, and part of that whole process was consolidating systems. They had over 80 billing systems, so it took years for us to consolidate down to one billing system. But those are the kind of things that you have to get visibility to. You can also tie that back to like business capability. So it's a capability, I want to ship product, I want to fulfill orders, those kind of capabilities, and what are the underlying systems that support them, and understanding where that fits within the customer journey. Then you define kind of, you understand the requirements, so to speak, and the opportunities, the pain points, that sort of thing. Define what your current state and your target state look like, and then identify the gaps between them. We showed you like reference architecture, Gartner architecture, that sort of thing, and then define your future state. And I should have mentioned earlier, you need to be really careful with this idea of reference architecture and even the Gartner model, that you're not kind of building like a vendor-defined architecture, I like to call it. So you get some big software vendor XYZ, and you look at their reference architecture, and they say, here's all the products you need. Well, that really is just like, to me, a vendor-defined architecture. It's not best in class. It really doesn't try to match up with the requirements and priorities and that sort of thing. So those things, those steps are all have to be done.
Yeah,
so then you,
oh,
sure.
Go ahead, sorry.
I was going to say one thing not to forget as you define that future state, and you make a great point there, Eric. It's for you, and you have to define it what you need, and don't forget things like innovation. You know, innovation is about the future state that you don't yet know of, and if you don't yet know what it is, and you have to spend time thinking about how you're going to make yourself sufficiently agile and flexible in order to meet those future needs. Sorry, Mike, I'll let you keep going.
No, that's a great point. Yeah, the idea that you need that platform that you can innovate on top of, that's the whole API story, that if you build the API, then developers can build on top of you. You really don't know what they're going to build, but you give them that capability to experiment. The other side of it is that whole idea of the legacy system, locking in that legacy business model, that you can't innovate. I'll give you an example there. We had a customer, really had a pretty simple request, and it was around some of the integration software that we had implemented there. They wanted to set up a custom loyalty program, which sounds like a pretty straightforward thing to do. You need customer information, that sort of thing. Well, it turned out their customer information was scattered across all these in-store systems. And it was duplicates, just dirty data, basically. So we had to tell them, well, it's going to cost all this money in order to implement it. So something that was a fairly simple request, and the business might just wanted to try it to see how that worked. So that idea, they want to do something innovative, but they can't. They can't. The IT says, well, we're going to have to do master the customer data and clean it, and it's going to take 6 months and $2 million and that kind of answer. That's not the way we can operate going forward. I mean, we have to be able to have this platform that we can innovate on top of. So back on point. So this whole organizational change that you have to affect, there has to be planning in there for that. And I'll show you some examples in a more detailed roadmap. And then what about the execution side of it? Or you can have a digital PMO and run that, or you can have other organizational structures like a company center, for example, around integration, a steering committee for the whole digital program. Those are the kind of questions that need to be in the plan. And then finally, you have to get down to actually executing. What do I do first? That first project, I mean, the low-hanging fruit, the project charters and the budget and that sort of thing. And here's some examples I just kind of pulled these from different customers around. Just, you need to show things in models visually, because there's just so much data here and it just can be overwhelming. So the right level of detail and something visual is very helpful. So with that, I'll give you something complex as another eye chart. But this is an actual roadmap. It was Visio, and you can see it really nice on Visio, but obviously shrunk this down. But I just really wanted to make a point here that this has got kind of different tracks or swim lanes, and they need to be viewed really together. So this has got data management and API management integration, and it's the two center swim lanes, and all the activities and things that you have to do to make those platforms work and stand those up and that sort of thing. But then there's also the idea of governance that has to go across the top of these. So you have to start looking at governance and data governance and, for example, who owns the API and how is it versioned and how do I notify consumers that the API has changed, and just all of those things that have to be answered and have to be put in place in the context of executing these projects. And then this last swim lane is things that cut across different projects, things like agility, agile development lifecycle, DevOps or CI/CD automation, which is where a lot of people start. Where are you going to introduce these concepts? And you really have to be mindful that you want to mature these over time. So you want to introduce this with some funded business project, for example. That's a lot of companies, they can't do anything until they have a funded project. Then introducing that in that context. So that's the idea of really trying to progress your maturity forward in the context of doing these projects and being mindful of executing against them. So with that, I've got one more survey. What do you think your greatest challenge to your digital transformation journey? Please select all that apply. I'll have some coming in. Okay, let's take a look. Managing the cultural process shift and executing the roadmap. Very interesting. So the culture shift is not a surprise. Just executing against the roadmap is a little bit surprising. Mike, do you have any comments on the findings here, the results?
What's amazing is how often you look at the fact that you've got so many people working across. And as we come and get your results, and we can skip to the results right now, it's not just one thing, is what you're saying. It's many things that are impeding your ability to get to that end result.
Right, and then the people thing's hard. I mean, that's what we talked about before. It's definitely difficult. Then that's why it's so important to affect the people change in the context of just doing projects. The first, for example, the first Agile project, so we've been in that position before, so the first Agile project really just trying to get the correct terminology. So we're talking about sprints and two-week sprints and having stand-ups and the kind of the ceremony around it. And just as you go through those projects and do a simple one first and then get better and better at it, so you just have to kind of go through the playbook, keep executing the plays, like a sports analogy. Okay, getting started. So Perficient does have a self-assessment. We call it a CX IQ, Customer Experience IQ. It really looks at the maturity of a customer experience across seven dimensions. So you could take this. It'll give you a self-assessment. Michael, do you want to add anything here to this? I know that you're highly involved with that.
Oh, yeah, and this is the key, right? Just what Eric was saying on some previous slides. You know, you don't move forward until you know where you stand. Where are the gaps? And the gaps, even though we're talking about platforms and you know, data and integration and so on and so forth, governance, agile, you know, culture and so on and so forth, you really need to take an overall view, because the overall view will help highlight some of those gaps that you may not realize that you have, especially in terms of what the customer experience is going to drive for you. And that's key. It's not just focusing on the gaps that exist from a technology perspective, but all of the gaps, and that will help you prioritize everything.
Okay. I think that concludes our time. Do we have any questions?
And so now, if anybody has questions, additional questions, please utilize the chat box to submit those. And we'll run through some of the first ones we got. So one of the main questions, you showed a lot of, you know, diagrams and reference architecture that you can execute against and assess yourself against. Where can people find those reference architecture materials? How do they develop those on their own?
Yeah, that's a good question. So I mentioned earlier, like, the idea of a vendor-defined architecture. I mean, you could take a look there. For example, there are, just Google, like, integration architecture, and you can find some examples. But just be very careful that those are kind of vendor-based, and that those will lead you into their product stack. So you really can go back to Gartner. I mean, Perficient and other consulting companies, for example, have these reference architecture that we've built and worked on across many customers. It is very helpful to have someone that's done it before, so to speak. So, but you can do it through your own reference and start to understand and look at what other companies have done. You know, like the Netflix example is really famous, but you're probably not going to be Netflix, so it's not going to be like that. But you can get some ideas, that sort of thing.
Great. And in terms of building your roadmap and then executing against it, what is the typical time period in which you're executing that roadmap? How long does that typically take?
So we've seen some that last multiple years, but you really should think about it like at different levels of detail. So you might have, for example, a five-year plan, and the five-year plan might be to get off some legacy system. It may be some fairly large chunks of functionality. I was just working for an insurance company. They're looking at claims processing and enrollment and things like that, moving that off the mainframe in these large chunks. It's a multi-year program, but really you could look at in finer detail something like, well, how long is it going to take me to stand up the kind of the digital platform pieces? Like you could look at integration and also API management and those kind of things, and then data. So how do I get closer to really understanding kind of customer insights from data? So that's kind of what I showed on that one roadmap was data integration was those threads we were looking at, and that was an 18-month, but obviously a lot more detail. Again, looking at what is the deliverable needs to look like in that level of detail. In a five-year plan, it's kind of much higher level. It might have the like block diagrams of the systems that change over time. This is what it's going to look like now in 6 months and in 1 year, 18 months, and that sort of thing. So you just have to adjust that level of detail for that time frame.
Great. And then we've gotten a couple questions around, people and process. It sounds like that's kind of the biggest area where people struggle to kind of execute against. How does the roadmap help align that people and process element?
So,
are some best practices for really focusing on people and process?
There's some of it. So the idea of looking at maturity and having targets, looking at things like governance and trying to shift, that's what we do a lot as well. So if you're looking at how to introduce data governance or how to introduce like API governance around that, you can look at your current software development lifecycle and hopefully you're moving more to an agile lifecycle. And then so what are the deliverables that I need now for an API? So what describes the API and how where should I put that deliverable in the context of the software development lifecycle? And do I review that? For example, if I have an API standard, do I review against that standard before it goes into production? That would be a new policy around it. So that's the idea of governance. So introducing the new stuff in the context of what's already there is very helpful because it's not such a radical change. But you are going to have to introduce things that are really new and maybe more radical. And then you could do that in the context of like an innovation lab, kind of carve that out, and then kind of like leave breadcrumbs for other people to follow in the forms of standards and guidance. And guidance would be, for example, at a high level, a pattern that says if you have this kind of problem, it's an ETL tool. If you have this kind of problem, it's an API. And that kind of guidance and architecture patterns and those kind of things that help bring other people along. And then, you know, you've got training plans and all these other things. And then in the context of the roadmap, those things need to be in there. And then you need to see those. When do I do the training? Well, I do the training right before I install and stand up the platform. So those things are in different swim lanes. There's a people swim lane that has the training. There's a platform swim lane that has, here's the platform, get stood up. So the training needs to be right here. Those kind of things that you have to get that all lined up. And the issue is if you don't, it slows down all the projects that you're trying to execute. If you get to the point where you don't have governance with APIs, for example, and all of a sudden I need to version it, well, then what do? It's kind of like a chaotic scramble, and everybody needs to, if you change it and there's an in-flight project using it, it screws it up. You know, it's just a lot of things that can moving parts that you need to get kind of aligned in that roadmap.
Great. Well, those are all the questions we have right now. If we didn't go through your question, we'll be reaching out to you with a response. And to wrap up, just as a reminder, we will be sending out the recording and a link to the slides. We will also be sending out that link to the CXIQ, which is a free self-assessment that covers the dimensions that impact your CX experience, and also covers some of those areas of platform modernization and aligning culture with your digital transformation goals. So that is completely free and will provide you personalized results prepared by our team. So take a look at that. We also have a great guide out right now on the top 10 trends around digital transformation that you need to know. With that, thank you for joining us today, and thank you to our presenters, Eric and Mike.
This concludes today's call. Thank you for your participation. You may now disconnect.